Hello, hello, welcome to the Victoria Beale YouTube channel. All of you out there in social media land, today we've got an absolutely amazing person. The person whose channel this is, Victoria Beale. She's a super connector, a global lead generator, a royal correspondent for NTV. She's a woman who has ADHD. I have dyslexia. We get on very well because of our neurodivergence. And literally, listen to this interview and then connect with her straight away, because no matter what you're looking for, she can help you. Obviously for a fee. So let's go on to asking some questions about Victoria, where she's going, what she can do for you, and why you should contact her. It's going to be a great interview, so let's get on with it. Give you Victoria Beale. Victoria, hello.
Hello, my darling. How are you?
I'm all the better for seeing you, and you are the person that owns this channel, and this is a great opportunity for us to dive into the past, dive into some of the problems that you've had and what you've learned from that. So you want to go back to 2009?
Yes, I do.
Tell me.
Thank you, Jonathan. Well, lovely to be here, and welcome to my channel. It's evolving, and Jonathan's been working very hard. Thank you so much for all the wonderful interviews you've been doing. But yeah, 2009. Okay, so I was approached after being in recruitment for 20 years in corporate, all the way up to director level. I had my own recruitment business. I was tempted away in 2009. Really, it took me by surprise, because that was the year that I met Chris Akabusi, the Olympic athlete.
Yeah.
And now he's a motivational speaker, amazing guy. Hello, Chris, if you're watching. And we're still in touch now and again as well. But Chris and I, our paths crossed at a networking event. He was actually speaking at a networking event I was attending as a guest here in Milton Keynes. And I just thought he was great. You know, he got all these people up in suits, throwing their arms around at 7 o'clock in the morning for a networking breakfast. And I thought, you know, I need to go and speak to him afterwards. So I was, again, a mother of three kids at the time. I have five now, but we'll talk about that later. But the three kids I had are very small, and I was returned to work at mum. And I was very proud of the fact that I was a director of this recruitment business in partnership with Aaron Wallace, Sales Recruitment. Hello, Darren and Rob, if you're watching as well. Hope you're doing well. So, yeah, so I went up to Chris and I said, look, I think you're great. I thought your speech was amazing. I know you're famous, but I don't really follow your career. I said, I'm a return to work mum. I've got a directorship in a recruitment business. Here's my card. And that was about it. And he was like, oh, thanks a lot. You know, you're great, blah, blah, blah. So I thought, well, I'm never going to hear from him again. But that was, you know, worth me doing. So anyway, went back to my office, and bearing in mind, guys, this was before social media was really that big a deal.
Yeah,
this is how old I am as well, giving my age away here. So there was no kind of like, oh, let's have a selfie. There was no such thing as a selfie in 2009. Isn't that crazy to say that?
Yeah.
Anyway, so there we were. Went back to my office, and the phone rang. And my colleague, Darren, said, oh, it's Chris Akabusi on the phone for you. I was like, really? You're joking. He's like, yeah. So got the phone call. I said, hi, Chris, how are you? He goes, oh, I think you're wicked. I think you're great. And we're going to do something together. I'm a motivational speaker, and you're in recruitment. I don't know what we're going to do together, but stay in touch. So we did. Anyway, then I got an invitation through from the Institute of Sales and Marketing Management. They were often sending me these flyers, you know, come to this event, come to that one. So this thing came through and said, bring a plus one, bring a guest. So I thought, do you know what? I'm going to see if Chris is available, as you do. So I contacted him and he goes, yeah, I'll come with you. So I thought, brilliant. So the event happened. We went, I walked in the room. I felt very, very honoured and proud to have Chris Akabusi next to me. And it was an amazing speech to this day. I remember the guy that was the speaker, Matt Crabtree. Hello, Matt, if you're watching as well, from a company called Positive Momentum. And then we had a great event there, and we went and had a pizza at Pizza Express at Shoreditch, Chris and I. Anyway, a couple of wines, having a great time and chatting, whatever. And I said, Chris, I've got this really like passion about doing something. Because if you remember rightly, John, 2009 credit crunch downturn, remember all those terms we were fed by the media? So there's me going, well, I'm not having this. I've got to put food on the table. I've got to pay my mortgage. I've got to pay the bills. So let's just be the antichrist to the credit crunch downturn. So Chris was like, yeah, great idea. Got his diary out. And there he was like basically saying, let's do this event together. And I was like, oh my God, what have I done? So I had to go along with it when I was basically, committed. So we decided to go for September 17th, 2009. And I just get up. I'm just about to go to the ladies. He goes, what should we call the event? What should we call the event? I'm like, I don't know, make it happen or something. He went, yeah, that's a great name. And that's how it happened, seriously. And so I was given like 3 or 4 months to put this whole thing together. Now, I've never put an event together, a conference in my entire life. This is the first time. But Chris, bless him, he trusted me. He said, well, you're in recruitment. You know what you're doing. You're a good negotiator. So I went to Whitbread Hall, which is just up the road from me here. A lovely place, by the way. And hello to the guys at Whitbread. Lisa, if you're still the sales manager there, went to Whitbread Hall and I negotiated with them the Brooklyn suite. Now Whitbread is also very famous for hosting the F1 drivers for Silverstone every year, so it's right next door to Silverstone, just so you know. So it's a very prestigious place, very well known, and basically I managed to get them to give me the venue and the catering and everything for free.
Really?
Because, yep, it was initially as a £30,000 charge or bill, and I said no, we won't be paying that. I said, but if we do as a charity event, and then we start to take it down the charity route, supporting Chris's charity. Now, Chris's charity in Nigeria basically helps young parents, particularly mothers, set up a little small business so they can be empowered and basically, feed their kids and clothe them and stuff. So I explained this to Wilbury Hall. I said, look, we're going to be doing this for Chris's charity's foundation. I said, could you please be a venue partner? Instead, we'll give you a little speaking slot. So there I kind of had to, off the top of my head, give them something that they would be attracted to. And sure enough, they said yes, which was great. So then we were selling the tickets at £250 each. And of course, it was pretty much, 100% profit. So, less costs. But I gave my time for free and loads of other people, Jane Pontefract as well, if you're listening. She was Chris's PA at the time. See, I remember all these people. It's all part of the journey. And so we did the event. September the 17th happened. We had 127 people show up.
Excellent.
We had board level directors of Ramada Encore. We had Fujitsu, who were the photographic company at the time, Prudential, some big names. And then we had what I call the good and great of Milton Keynes and Northamptonshire. So, your SMEs and business owners. And still to this day, people will contact me on LinkedIn and say, I remember that event you did. And, because that really warms my heart. So that was the first event I did, my idea, my concept. Chris evolved it further. He then did a further 4 years worth of Make It Happens. So I did the first three with him and then he did two more. So it became something, and that was on the cusp of Facebook, LinkedIn, everything booming on social media as well. So we went from selling out events using the phone and emails, basically, and the press as such, to basically everything going online, sponsored ads and all the rest of it. So yeah, I was quite lucky to be part of that transition from being a young child not having a mobile phone or knowing what the internet was, to all of a sudden seeing this entire digital boom and the growth. So I feel quite blessed to be of the generation that I'm in.
Hmm.
So then that
Can I,
looks
just before you
gone.
go on, well, no, because I'll tell you what, this is one of the things that I find with neurodivergent people, is that we are so thankful for things that other people take for granted. And gratitude practice has been demonstrated to improve happiness in life and at work. And yet, most people would never consider themselves lucky. I consider myself lucky to have had horrible disabilities happen to me because, as a result of that, I've learned how to overcome. Carry on. Sorry for that interruption.
Total gratitude to everything, good and bad. And I'm the same as you know. That's why we get on so well. But make it happen happened. And that was like a transition for me because I realized that recruitment, I'd done my stint in recruitment. I'd had enough of it. I'd enjoyed it. I mean, don't get me wrong, I did very well in recruitment. But then I started to be attracted to creation and promotion of events. That's when that happened in 2009, that transition. So I left my directorship. I walked away from recruitment. I then started to focus on creating events full time and promoting them. Soon after my success with Make It Happen, because it's all over the papers, and to the point I was walking into Tesco's, my local shop. People were like, "Oh, I saw you on the front cover of the Citizen," which is the Milton Keynes, like the rag here, and stuff like that. So that was my first sort of taste of local fame, if you like.
Well, I will take this moment then because we're really getting into the delves of this. I think what we'll do is we'll play your song and then we'll add another one at the end. So
All
this
right then.
first one is Titanium. Why did you choose Titanium?
Well, I love Sia. She's got an amazing voice, first of all, and David Guetta. I think that's David Guetta, isn't it? And I'm a very sort of, I like to, people who know me know I like to have a good party. I like a good celebration with my Irish blood. But the words are very poignant for me because I do feel like I've had a lot thrown at me. And, I'm not a victim by any means, but, I do feel quite a strong every time I get slammed down, I get back up again. And
Yeah.
so I thought
So,
titanium
yeah.
was prudent.
The wording and the idea, because titanium is the second strongest material that humans have found, so that very well blends with you. So enjoy this song, and we'll come back in a moment. Welcome back. So as long as YouTube allows us to upload that tune, you've just heard Titanium by David Guetta and Sia. Victoria, we're being recognised as we walk into the supermarket. Where does it go from there?
Exactly. Well, I thought that was quite weird. So anyway, then I realised obviously the power of having a really good event and then getting some really good press from the sort of post-event. If you like the buzz. But then my mind started working because obviously, you know, telesales, cold calling, that's kind of, that's where I've been very strong since I was 16, since I left school. So there's my mind starting to create a product that would involve having an event and creating it and then promoting it and then lead generation and all the rest of it. So that's when that kind of started. However, Business Live, everyone wants to know how Business Live thing started. And I'm not sure if everyone really knows, but I was approached by a restaurant called Bistro Live, who is still running to this day as it goes. Now Bistro Live approached me through the wonderful Neil Muxlow. Neil, if you're watching, hello as well. Again, these are key people who have made a difference in my life and my personal career. And Neil came to me and said, look, Bistro Live want to do a networking event or a corporate event at their place in Milton Keynes. Now the restaurant trade was obviously, you know, flailing slightly because of the credit crunch and downturn at the time. So I said, okay, I'll happily do it. They wanted us to do it commission only, but Neil and I said no. And so we set up Business Live Limited. That's basically Bistro Live, Business Live. Mm-hmm. We said, look, you need to create another brand. We want to be attractive to corporates. The only way we can do that is give it a different name, and that's how that started. So it's purely, again, I suppose you said by accident these things are happening. Business Live happened 5-6 years we were together. We ended up rolling out in Milton Keynes, Leicester and Nottingham. So I was up and down the M1 three times a month to different locations, met some great people, still connected to all of them to this day. I then whilst Business Live was happening, I set up my telemarketing business, and my telemarketing business underpinned some of the sales and promotion for all of those events as well. So the two things ran together. And that's a fantastic case study because Bistro Live obviously went on to win awards, turn over millions. They're doing really well now. They've still got the Bistro Live Business Club, which they're running in Leicester very successfully at their Leicestershire branch, I believe. So yeah, that was a great experience for me, and I look back with very fond memories. Anyway, fast forward 10 years. Now we're going to jump forward in time, 2019. So in June 2019, I'd already clocked up about 3,000 events in the UK, corporate events mainly for SMEs and business leaders, property events, and then sort of 2019 I started to get into health and wellness events, which was really bizarre because then obviously COVID happened the following year. But anyway, the 2019 I'd just given birth to baby number 5, little Zane. Aww. And as you do, you know, two month old baby, decided to restart Business Live UK Limited. Okay, so Business Live UK Limited was set up because everyone knew me for Business Live. It was a big part of my life. And by then I'd already kind of acquired the company because Bistro Live, you know, were doing so well. They didn't need to have Business Live anymore. So I took it over. And basically, you know, then 2020, I remember my last event I did was in the West End. It was a David Bowie art collection for Masterpiece Art. Hello, Mark and Alex as well. I hope you're watching this. But we did a David Bowie collection. And just to give you an idea, so they basically paid a retainer to my consultancy, Business Live UK Limited, to create an opening for, you know, exhibition opening for David Bowie. Obviously, he'd obviously passed by then. Mm-hmm. So we had all his paintings and stuff. They had only normally got 2 or 3 people to the gallery beforehand, but then engaged in our services and we got over 150 people in the gallery, which I have a video as well to show you which I can, we can put in this video or something else, but we have it in the YouTube channel, so you can find it. But we called it from Major Tom to Major Arcana. That was the name of the collection. And that was fascinating. We got Anthea Turner there and her partner, Guy Portelli, who's a famous sculptor, loads of other famous art dealers and stuff. And it's a really huge buzz. And I believe they actually sold a fair bit of the works from that event. So I still am in touch with these guys to this day. So that was it. And then, of course, bang, COVID happened.
Yeah.
You know, 2020. Yeah. Now, in my personal life, which is something that I don't really talk about that often, but it is worth mentioning, whilst I was doing all these great things and events, I had a young family. My partner was not the best partner in the world. I was the sole breadwinner for the for the family for the entire time I was with my ex. And you know, it's very, very tough, you know, being heavily pregnant twice. Two kids are very close together as well in age, and also trying to run a business of this nature, and be the front person for events. I mean, many a time I had to take the baby or the babies when they were very young to the events with me that I was running, you know, which was just looking back, I was thinking, what was I doing? But at the time, you just do what you have to do.
Well, I think what's worth pointing out for viewers, if they haven't realised it already, Victoria and I have a habit of saying, oh, basically, we just did this. But just this, to normal people, is an incredible list of events and activities and planning and structure. And it all happens inside her brain as it happens inside my brain. I see it as I want it. So does she. So the intro to this show, I said, why you'd want to connect with Victoria. This is why you want to connect with Victoria. Carry on.
Bless you. Thank you. I mean, I was obviously suffering a lot of mental abuse from my partner because, you know, I was kind of out there working, earning the money. He wasn't really doing anything or wanting. He did want to do stuff, but he wasn't applying himself. He's a very intelligent guy, speaks multiple languages, but he wasn't applying himself to something. I, you know, multiple times tried to involve him in my business, which is the wrong thing to do as well. And I learned from that. But the fact is, people either want to do it or they don't. And he didn't. And, you know, there I was doing everything. I was the mother, I was the cook, the cleaner, the taxi driver, you know, the breadwinner. I was doing the role of like 10 people on a daily basis. So, you know, actually in 2019, it all came to a head. And I did almost suffer a breakdown, if you want to call it that, because it got too much. And that was serious because then, you know, after that, the future of my children was on the line. But actually what happened was in 2020, in May 2020, so deep in lockdown, you know, I was told, we were instructed to separate. He had to move out by the social services. It was a case of, he moves out, otherwise we'll take your children off you. And that's how serious it was. Yeah. And not many people know about this. And I thought it was time to share it because there's a lot of, I suppose, speculation as to, you know, who I am as a person and whatever. I think when you put yourself out there, people almost assume that they know you the inside out. And I feel for really famous people, you know, it must be absolutely horrendous for them. So, you know, this is why I'm sharing the story, because it's really important that I do. This is the right time. But anyway, so then obviously we parted ways. So there I was with an elder child who was 14 at the time, who didn't want to go back to school, didn't want to homeschool. And he was pretty much suicidal. We actually went on national news with him talking about his lockdown experiences. So, yeah, that was on national news. My daughter was doing fairly well at school, but you know, she'd obviously suffered a bit of trauma with everything that happened. And then my younger two were kind of, you know, under the age of three. But, you know, again, required me all the time. So there we are, the nappy changing and all the rest of it. So no childcare, no partner. These 40 kids, and of course, my entire company was based on events. So what happened overnight? Everything shut down. So you could say it was the worst time of my life. It pretty much was, because I moved away from my family many years ago. You know, I've lived in Milton Keynes like 23 years, and all my kids have grown up here. But I left my family network, who are based in Newbury, which is like 2 hours down the road.
Yeah.
So it was difficult for them because they couldn't see us. It was lockdown. So then we were all just stuck in our bubble in the house. So I thought to myself, well, what do I do? Do I go and, you know, become an Amazon driver, you know, like all good people were trying to do and earn a crust? Or do I try and do something with this huge network that I've built? So I decided the latter. And I literally woke up one day and I thought, right, I'm going to create business live online. Okay. So I did. And February 2021, we launched the first one. We had 250 people register, 125 showed up. And lo and behold, I forgot to tell you this, we had a bot come on, which was an experience. Because, of course, we'd only just started using Zoom, hadn't we? We didn't know what Zoom was. I don't think Zoom even was invented before lockdown. It might have been. Sorry,
probably.
Zoom. But we didn't know too much about all these things. And so this guy came on, or we thought it was a guy. He was, like, shouting. I couldn't mute him. And so I had to get 125 people off that Zoom and then back onto a new one. Oh, it was a nightmare. And I'm sure people... Now I look back and laugh. At the time, I was like, my God, the first one, how can you do this to me? Anyway, I think we managed to get most people back on. Great event. People loved it. And it was literally business live online, as I said. That's what it says on the tin. So breakout rooms, table hosts or Zoom hosts. It was wonderful. And as it happens, I did that for 3 years, monthly, facilitated those events for 3 years. That's how it happened. But 6 months in, so we're in 2020, 2021, 6 months in, I realised people were dialing in from all over the world now. I thought, actually, there's an opportunity here. Not just UK. I didn't realise I had fans or people coming in from Thailand even waking up at the stupid o'clock or staying up till stupid o'clock. So I thought, right, I'm going to change the company name. So I changed it to Business Live Global. And then I created a little membership fee just to keep things afloat. And that's how Business Live Global evolved. And then
so,
in July, sorry, you're going to ask me something.
Well, yeah, so I want to move on to what you're doing now, because the life story, hey, you've got at least two books in you. So I met you through Business Life Global. We were introduced by Mark Jarrett, I think. And
yes,
immediately got on well. And Business Life Global, I can see it in my head the same way you could, but it's quite difficult, especially when it's not been conceived of, to create something so global. So what I'm interested in is, where are you heading now? What is your purpose?
Well, I decided after 3 years of BLG and networking that I was done, and I've handed all my members and the whole thing across to Table Network, which is run by Ed Folks. And then I pulled back and I basically said, right, you know, I am a consultant first and foremost. I've got this network. I've built, you know, I've got contacts in about 40 countries worldwide of influence, and I need to do something with it. I'm ready to do that now. So my consultancy, VCB Global, you will see the new website soon,
nice.
Which has captured all of my sort of back catalogue of every event that I've done and all the rest of it. But what I'm doing now is I'm basically helping companies, you know, as I was 10, 15 years ago, helping companies create events and promote them, use events as a means to generate leads.
Mm.
If done properly, both online and live, you will get a much, much better conversion rate and also a better attrition rate, because your customers are more likely to stay with you. And I've got plenty of statistics and case studies to prove all of that.
Mm.
That's where I'm at now. Obviously, I'm still a part-time TV presenter, which also was a gift that happened during lockdown. Because I launched in Africa, which I'll tell you about another time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I've had some amazing people join my business, and people also who were the best intentions join, but it didn't quite work out, you know. So the consultancy is well underway now.
So you're a lead generator. So I'm a company. So in some ways it's recruitment, because you're helping companies recruit customers.
Basically,
yes. Yeah. And well, you see, that's very interesting, because doing it in the way, so having had the networking experience and the live event, a good contact of mine, Manuel Barragan, in Mexico, he talks a lot about the customer experience. And so if you're generating leads because they come to an event, that's going to be so much more powerful.
It is. And also, you see, people who come to the event who may not sign up as a customer, they're still in your funnel as a lot warmer than someone who didn't come to an event. You know, I don't care what people say, John. I love AI, but trust me, I love AI. But, you know, when you put HI, human intelligence, and AI together, that's when you've got something special. Mm. And you can never, ever, ever get away from shaking someone's hand, meeting them in person, whether it's on Zoom, whether it's face to face. You're always going to have a much better relationship, so a much better business relationship as well. You know, so that's what I'm very deeply passionate about. There is a way of setting up an event, creating it, and doing it properly. There's a methodology which I've created myself over the years, which I implement, and it works, you know. And that's it. I mean, I've got two other companies that I'm setting up, but we'll save that for the next interview.
Exactly.
I'll talk about that next time.
Exactly. Well, listen, I'll tell you what, people watching will be amazed. I've learned things about you I didn't know before this call. Looking down the barrel of the camera, who do you want to speak to? What's the call to action?
Call to action will be business owners who want to develop their personal brand rapidly on a global scale, number one, and or businesses or corporations who want to, again, do the same thing using events as well. And as I say, we can fill rooms, we can fill Zooms. That's in essence what we do.
Excellent. Well, companies, you've heard the offer. You've heard about how Victoria, throughout her life, has challenged, exuded energy in a way that it's electrifying. Well, it's electrifying to someone like me, because I'm like her. I can only say you should reach out. Her LinkedIn profile will be in the notes under the video. Connect with her on LinkedIn. I'll put her Calendly link in as well. What would you like as a second favorite song?
Well, I've already thought about it. I mean, I was a massive Carpenters fan. I still am. My dad used to ram it down my throat, but I loved it so much. So I started to listen to Karen Carpenter's voice. And you know what? The song I love is We've Only Just Begun by the Carpenters.
Oh, yeah.
Because every morning you wake up and you can move, you can get out of bed, you can literally start that day afresh. You can start, this is a new day, forget about what happened yesterday. You know, so I think We've Only Just Begun is a good one. So
excellent.
Let's go with that.
Excellent. Okay. Thanks very much for the very candid interview. I hope people find it useful. Goodbye, everyone. Say goodbye, Victoria.
Goodbye.
Okay.
Thank you so much, John. I'll take care.
No worries. Cheers. Bye.
We've only just begun to live, white leaves and promises. A kiss for luck and we're on. thoughts, we smile. So much of life ahead. We'll find a place where there's room to grow. And yes, we've just begun.